Hi guys, thank you for tuning in. This is Siddharth this side. Today we'll be doing a small webinar on biomechanical assessment of runners. Before we dive into the topic, I'll just give you my brief introduction. So I am working as a product manager for GaitON, which is a motion analysis system. I have had 4 years of experience in biomechanical analysis. I have been active part on literature written on biomechanical assessments for runners with mid-portion Achilles tendinopathy issues. We've written good blogs on proximal hamstring tendinopathy problems, how to manage them through running. We've also been featured by good leading sources of sports medicine, sports science articles like Simply Faster from the US. And yes, we have been active a lot by working with certain good centers in the globe, around the globe, for biomechanical assessments, especially focused on running analysis. So in today's webinar, we'll be focusing on a lot of topics. The first of which is, how can a running assessment add value to my treatment protocols? So this is especially for people who are just planning to start doing running assessments and watching this webinar probably for that reason. So we'll be talking a lot of values that a running assessment can add to your typical treatment protocols, followed by that, where should we start if we want to introduce running analysis or do a gait analysis of a runner who's just coming? How do I start? What equipment do I need? What is the step-by-step process on doing it? Moving on, we'll be talking about, so once I've set up the equipment, whatever things that are required, what are the parameters that I can look out for while analyzing somebody's running gait, and how do these parameters correlate to clinical conditions like patellofemoral pain, tibial stress fractures, plantar fasciitis, or problems which are more commonly seen in a runner who's injured. So how to get the most out of this webinar? I suggest everybody to just turn off their email, Facebook, Skype, and other programs so that you can actually really follow the webinar and also develop your own ideas on how to take out the most value from the webinar. To start off, I'll just give you an outline on the step-by-step things that we'll be doing in the webinar. So we'll be first understanding runners and their training protocols. How do runners function? What are their training volumes? So basically getting an introduction on the runners, getting to know them better. Once we have known them better, then we'll be focused on running injuries. What kind of running injuries are more commonly seen in runners? Which are the areas that are affected? And after that, we'll be talking about the role of running analysis in the assessment process. Where does it fit in? What are the things that we can do to perform a comprehensive analysis of a runner? Then we'll be talking about the step-by-step process of setting it up. And in the end, we'll be talking about certain factors, certain biomechanical faults we can look out for in a running analysis. So let us look at the overall scenario of running first, which is pretty good to see because running is booming, which is quite logical also, because to start off running, you just need a basic pair of equipment like shoes and good clothing, and you can just straight away go for a run, which is why we've seen about 1.3 million runners complete their marathons worldwide in 2018, and the participation growth from 2008 to 2018 has risen up by 49.43%, which is approximately 50% growth. The highest growth has been seen by India with 229% of participation increase. This can be seen in a graphic on the right also, because in 2013 we had about 176 races and events, which rose up to about 1700 events in 2019. So this is in fact a very reaffirming figure also, because if there is a stark increase in runners, as clinicians we also need to be equipped from a runner's perspective to treat them and give them the best possible solutions. To do that, we have to first understand runners, how they function, what are their training protocols and all. So it's very essential to get to know running. Runners, what I feel, are very determined people. So you have to understand the psychology of a runner. They would do anything to keep continuing their running form. It's better if you get to know local events that they have, what kind of training strategies they use, what kind of training volumes they have. And because every particular marathon is organized at a particular time in the year, and the preparation starts much before that. So if you can pair up your rehab or strengthening programs along with their training procedure, it will give them a lot better results. It would be very difficult for them to do any change in the running form right close to the marathon. So if you are in sync with their training strategies, their training calendar, I think you would be able to add a lot of value. And you would be able to have a good conversation with them also. Perhaps if you also want to start up running, you will be able to have that kind of psychological mindset and would be able to understand their problems in a better manner. Understanding their typical volume for that, there is a very good solution that you can get in touch with a local coach, a running coach, or a running community. There are a number of running communities available worldwide, which are in form of Adidas Runners Club, Reebok Runners Club. There's a Kalenji community established by Decathlon. In addition to this, there are numerous local running clubs also available that you can get in touch with. By doing this, you will be able to get introduced to a lot of local runners, which again is very important because you'll end up treating them in some manner in later stages, and you'll be able to understand how these guys train, what are their timings. Because an average runner, so they train for about 80 to 100 kilometers a week. If they're preparing for a good marathon, this is a very normal average for them. So whatever things you do, whatever interventions you introduce, we have to take that into mind that this is a very normal running mileage, and it will be very difficult for them to reduce that mileage just because of the intervention program. So we have to make adjustments accordingly, keeping in mind their training volumes, which is why I feel getting to know them is a very important thing. One another very important thing is that running injuries may or may not be due to a physical limitation in the body. As clinicians, right now that we have seen is that there is a lot of focus happening on physical limitations in the body. Yes, it may play a very big role in leading to any injury. So any muscle problem, any structural problem, any poor tissue quality might, yes, lead to a lot of running injuries and might be a possible reason behind the injury. But there are other factors also. What kind of shoes you're wearing, what are your training loads that are happening, are there any technical faults in your running form? So all these problems combined can also lead to an injury. And if you consider all of them while giving a proper assessment, I think you will be able to add a lot of value because this will give them a very holistic approach. As I mentioned, there are other factors that impact your running form, so having a good knowledge about shoes and orthotic insoles is very important. Because even if you give them the best possible intervention program in the world and they are just in an incorrect pair of shoes, the nearby shoe store recommended them an incorrect pair of shoes, that can again be detrimental to injuries, and you will end up reducing the efficacy of your rehab program. So get in touch with your footwear store, understand what kind of shoe models that they have, what kind of biomechanical corrections do these shoes offer. In addition to that, get in touch with the local orthotist also, understand what kind of insoles they prescribe, what materials do they use, what kind of thicknesses they use for which conditions, what kind of assessments they do for prescribing somebody an insole. The last thing that you should understand about runners is that maybe running isn't for you, quote, is the least acceptable thing for a runner. As I mentioned, that runners are very determined, determined type of people, and they would want to do anything to continue running. A lot of runners, what I have seen, have experienced a lot of injuries, but still they would do anything to continue their running form. So, quoting maybe running isn't for you should be a last resort. Because what I feel is that body is again a very wonderful piece of art. It can adapt to a number of biomechanical changes that we can do. So there are a lot of things that we can do, still have in our hands to correct the problem of the runner. And maybe running isn't for you is probably something that I've seen only in the last cases that a clinician prescribes them, when nothing is possible. So keeping these factors in mind are very important whenever you have a runner coming in, so that you are able to step in their pair of shoes and understand what kind of psychologies they have. Let's talk about running injuries now. So as you can see, about 50% of the injuries happen at the knee region, with patellofemoral pain as a leading cause of those knee injuries, followed by the lower leg, which again has about quarter of the injuries in form of medial tibial stress syndrome, which is also known as shin splints, chronic exertional compartment syndromes, tibial stress fractures. Foot and ankle contribute to again about quarter of the injuries. Thigh injuries would include some things like thigh strains, quadriceps strains, then hamstring strains. Hip and pelvis injuries would include hip and groin injuries and all. So since we have talked about knee injuries as a major cause of injuries in running, let's talk about it in more amount of detail. So patellofemoral pain contributes about 48% of knee injuries. It's more female dominant with about 2-to-1 ratio. It more happens in females. There are speculations and out of studies that suggest that patellofemoral pain begins in adolescence, continues into childhood, and then eventually leads to patellofemoral osteoarthritis. But the evidence is still low, but it's developing day by day. Followed by tibial stress fractures. So tibial stress fractures also happen in a lot of runners. It depends a lot on activities also. So it generally varies from about 2-to-8%, but in somebody who's a military person, it increases to about 20% also. Again, it is more female dominant. It happens generally more in females, and it is particularly more devastating to a runner's program because it can send you to a loss in running program for about 6 to 9 months. And in patellofemoral pain, although it happens more, you can still continue a slight bit of running along with that pain, but tibial stress injuries can be really devastating to a runner. So that's why they have to be taken very seriously. Followed by iliotibial band syndrome. So it's the leading cause of lateral knee pain. If anybody comes to you for a lateral knee pain problem, this is the first thing you can check them with. And again, it's a female dominant problem. It's again a 2-to-1 ratio favoring females, which have this problem more. And followed by Achilles tendinopathy. So this is generally a problem that happens in males more, and I would say it happens generally in master runners over the age of 40. There are a number of treatment programs like eccentric trainings, then heavy slow weight trainings, and then isometric trainings. But in spite of these exercise programs, there have been a lot of cases when the person has ended up with chronic Achilles tendinopathy problems. Whatever is the nature of the injury or whatever is the location of the injury, there is one thing that is important to understand from a runner's point of view is the causes that can lead up to that injury. And the causes may not always be a musculoskeletal impairment or a physical limitation in the body. It can be a whole lot of other factors also that we have to take into account, and they also have a good chance of leading up to that injury. So it's important that we look at all the factors. The first factor that can lead up to a running injury, according to me, would be a musculoskeletal impairment, which would include any muscle imbalance, any structural problem, any degradation in tissue quality. So all of this would come under a musculoskeletal impairment. Other factors like training errors. So, what is the training volume that you have? How many kilometers you cover in a particular week? What is the pace at which you train? Is it high enough or not? Is it low enough for you? What is the warm-up criteria that you have? Do you do good enough cool down, stretchings and all? What is the distance that you run in a particular go? So, what is the diet that you have? What are the sleep patterns that you have? So, all of this would come under a training error category. Then there is another important part, which is faulty running mechanics. So a lot of runners, so runners is again a competitive sport at times. So when I'm a runner, I would have it in my mind to again win, to cover the maximum distance in the minimum amount of time. To ensure that, to cover maximum distance, people do a lot of biomechanical faults, which reflect in form of faulty running mechanics, which are very detrimental to in terms of injuries. They compromise shock absorption, they compromise good propulsion. So a lot of faulty running mechanics again is a major cause of injuries. We'll be covering a lot of this faulty running mechanics, how to identify them, how to correct them in the following slides. The last one is our extrinsic factors. So factors like shoes, what kind of shoes you have, what kind of biomechanical corrections do these shoes offer to you? Are they according to your clinical need or not? What kind of so age of the shoe is also a very important thing. How many kilometers have you already run with the shoe? What kind of insoles you are using? Are they customized insole? Are they over the counter insole? Do you absolutely need an insole or not? So all these factors are extrinsic factors that again hugely affect your running form. And a combination of these factors or any one factor in isolation can lead to injuries. As a clinician, it's important that you figure out which is the root cause of the injury that the person has come to us with. And If the root cause is an extrinsic factor, along with our rehab program, we have to correct that extrinsic factor also. If the problem is a training error, along with our rehab program, we have to correct that training error also. Only then we'll be able to resolve the root cause of the problem. This is where we can add a lot of value as a clinician who is more aware about running, because no other normal clinician who is not a lot of aware about running will he will not be looking into all of the other factors. They would just be understanding their body from a physical limitation point of view, probably treating the symptoms and giving them the solution, but that might lead to a lot of recurrent injuries. So as a clinician, it's important that we need to look at all the other factors also. Apart from the causes, it is equally important to understand how do these factors work and lead up to an injury, which brings us to a very important topic of envelope of function. So every athlete has a stress frequency curve or a load frequency curve, and that divides that athlete into a manageable zone and an excessive zone, as you can see here. So as we keep on increasing the load for that athlete, or we keep on increasing the frequency of training for that athlete, more is the chance of getting into that excessive zone. And again, if I'm training constantly into that excessive zone, that will take my chances up of getting injured. So this is what happens in an injured athlete. So when these loads get excessive or the frequency gets excessive, I end up getting injured, which in turn reduces my manageable zone, and it increases my excessive zone. So as an injured athlete, my role is to again constantly increase that manageable zone and reduce that excessive zone to again come into my comfortable zone again and again. So it's just the matter of increasing load or increasing frequency. If I'm increasing a lot of load too quickly, or if I'm increasing the frequency too quickly, I can end up coming into the excessive zone pretty fast. Again, where my body will not be capable to withhold that kind of load or with kind of frequency, which will lead to an injury. So the way to deal with this is we have to follow certain mitigation strategies. So what options can I take, or what multiple options can I take to reduce the chances of injuries? Either I can increase the ability to withstand stress, which will further increase the manageable zone and reduce the excessive zone. Now this can be done very easily using our intervention program. So any kind of rehab programs that we give, any kind of extrinsic factors or shoes that we use, somehow they increase the ability of the body to withstand that load, which increases the manageable zone. The other way around is to reduce the loads that are there, so that maintains the same amount of manageable zone, but I will never be able to reach that border between a manageable and an excessive zone. So again, I will not be having a lot of chances to get injured. So there are a number of strategies I can use for this. So for reducing the loads, I can straight away reduce their training volume. I can correct their running biomechanics also, because a lot of faulty running mechanics, they increase the loading on the body and different parts of the body, which increases the chances of crossing that manageable zone. So by correcting biomechanical faults, correcting running mechanic faults, by reducing the overall training volume, I can again manage to ensure that they are not getting injured very frequently. So it's all a combination actually. I can use multiple factors also. I can use my strength and conditioning programs to increase their ability to withstand stress. I can also simultaneously correct their running mechanics to reduce the overall loading that is happening on their body. Let's talk about the treatment protocols that good centers use for treating their runners. So once the runner has come to your center, the first step that is involved is taking a good injury and training history. In the injury history, we include any running related injuries that they have had in the past, which we just discussed previously also. In the training history, they ask about specific factors like what is the training volume that they have, how many distance do you cover, how much distance do you cover per week, what pace do you run at, what are the warm-up strategies that you have, what are the cool downs that you do, is there any uphill running involved, is there any downhill running that is involved, what is the distance that they run in one go, what are their dietary plans, Then what are their aspirations? Do you want to run a particular race? When is that race going to happen? So that allows them to understand the mental makeup of that runner and the loads that they want to take up in the future. So you can probably design a program around that. And a lot of times, understanding the training or the injury history also immediately leads to the cause of the problem also. You can immediately understand the cause of the problem. So injury and training history is the first step and it's a very important step, followed by a physical examination where you actually understand if there is any physical limitation in the body or not. You remember that we discussed a particular cause, which was musculoskeletal impairment. So this is where you figure out if there is any physical limitation in the body in form of any muscle imbalance, any kind of structural problem involved or not. And next comes any diagnostic test or imaging that you would want to again come to a conclusion. Followed by this would be a footwear examination. Footwear, as I told you, is part of an extrinsic factor that can lead up to an injury. So by footwear, I mean you would also involve an insole examination. So you would first analyze what kind of shoes that they are in. What kind of biomechanical corrections do these shoes offer to the runner? Does the runner need those biomechanical corrections or not? This is again a very important question. A lot of times, shoe stores recommend shoes that are not suitable for that runner, which might lead to problems. So, footwear examination would include a detailed assessment of shoes. You can also understand the wear pattern of the shoe by just looking at the shoe. You should ask the runner to get the running shoe along with them when they come to you for the first visit, so you can actually see the wear pattern also. Which areas of the footwear do they run most on? So that would be worn out the most. And in overpronated people, there is a specific area that is worn out more as compared to underpronating people and Newton people. So then comes insoles. What kind of arch supports, what kind of other corrections do the insoles provide them, what kind of material is there in the insole? This is all covered in a footwear examination. The last step, which is a very important step, is a running analysis. A running analysis is when we ask the runner to run on a treadmill or on the ground, we are able to actually see them running. We can correlate all the other factors that we detected above. So if there is a problem with the footwear, we can actually see what is the effect of the footwear on the running mechanics. If there is a problem with the physical limitation in the body, then we can see how is that affecting the running form. Another important factor that we can figure out if there is any technical fault or not, which might lead to injuries. So running analysis forms the last step, which is again a very important step. The essence of this, all these tools, is to correlate all these results. Once you have done all the type of tests, all the tools you have used, it's important to correlate all of them and then arrive at a decision. Let's talk about the running analysis part of it now. So in a running analysis, as I mentioned, we will be watching them run or we will be capturing their running motion. So in order to do that, you will need a set of digital cameras. You can start with just one camera also, or a phone probably, which has a good slow motion feature facility. You can have the specifications checked on the website of the camera or the phone that they should at least offer 60 FPS. Or if you plan to take up any camera or a phone, you can probably drop me a mail or a message also. I'll be happy to help you out for all the technical aspects of what kind of setup you need. So you basically need a camera phone or a digital camera which has a good slow motion feature facility. Then you need a good motion analysis software. Now, motion analysis software again depends upon your requirements. Do you want to do a qualitative examination or do you want to do a quantitative examination? So, qualitative examination can be just by playing or pausing the video. Using your own eyes, you can just see in the slow motion whether the person is doing a biomechanical fault or not. So, that is a very qualitative examination. Yes, it has a lot of variations from one person to other, a lot of, so there's no objectivity to the analysis, but it's a good step to start with. The another alternative could be using a professional software with a reporting feature, so it will probably list everything down for you. Like this is what we follow in GaitON. It lists down all of the running biomechanical faults that are present, by how much is it going out of range, and all of the abnormal regions that are there in the running activity, and what are the asymmetries that are present. So it depends what you want exactly. If you want to just start slow, you can also start up with just a play pause kind of an observational analysis. Irrespective of whatever method you do, you have to capture a total of four views of the runner, which would include the right lateral view, anterior view, left lateral view, and the posterior view. The right lateral view I typically capture up to the C7 of the person. If you are not able to capture up to the C7, I would recommend do capture up to the midline of the trunk at least, if there is a space problem. Same goes for the left lateral view also. For anterior view, you can capture up to the center of the patella, just above than that, or you can also capture up till the ASIS regions. For posterior view, I recommend that you capture top to bottom, so you should be able to see the C7 and the foot of the person. So these are the views you can capture. Once you have captured the videos using one or more cameras from all of these four views, you have to start identifying biomechanical faults in the running form. Now, in the following slides, you'll be looking at those biomechanical faults, that what do these faults look like. And so whatever is the fault does not matter. Just keep in mind that the fault can be a result of a physical limitation in the body. It can be due to a training error problem. It can be due to an extrinsic factor. It can also be due to a technical fault in the running form. So all the four problems can lead to the same biomechanical fault. And as a clinician, it's important that we figure out whichever is the root cause of the problem, and that you can do with the help of the tools that we just talked about. The first fault that we'll be talking about would be overstriding. So overstriding is indeed a very common biomechanical fault that you will find in a lot of amateur runners who is just taken up running, who are not aware about running form. Overstriding is a fault that you can identify on video around the foot strike or initial contact when they have just struck the ground. It is identifiable using two important factors. One is inadequate knee flexion. Second one is inclined tibia. By inclined tibia, in extended position, I mean that the lateral malleolus goes ahead of the lateral epicondyle of the femur at foot strike. So these two characteristics are indicative of somebody who is overstriding. Now, overstriding is a fault that people generally do to increase their performance if it is a technical fault. So how does that work is, so if I am extending my knee a lot at initial contact, I am increasing the stride length. So if I increase my stride length, I am able to cover larger distance in a lesser amount of time, which increases my performance obviously. So overstriding is a strategy that people use to increase their performance by getting that extra stride length. The problem is that the extra stride length is increased at the cost of knee flexion, which is required at initial contact. At initial contact, our foot strike, when I'm just landing, there is approximately 2 to 2.5 times the body weight exerted by the ground on my stance phase leg that has just struck the ground. So I need to absorb that shock well in order to prevent any kind of excessive joint loading from traveling up the body, and then it leads to a lot of problems. So in order to absorb that shock, I need to flex my knee. Knee flexion is a good strategy for shock absorption. And if somebody who is overstriding, they are having excessive of knee extension, they will never be able to flex their knee at initial contact, which compromises shock absorption. So which is why a lot of problems that happen in people who are overstriding are related to the knee region, which is patellofemoral pain, infrapatellar tendinopathy, IT band problems, then there is greater trochanter syndrome. A lot of vulnerability also increases at the tibia region in somebody who is overstriding, so it generally leads to a lot of medial tibial stress syndrome, bone stress injuries, exertional compartment syndrome problems. So overstriding is a very common fault to look out for. General causes, as I mentioned, that behind any biomechanical fault, there can be physical limitations or there can be technical errors also. Physical limitations that generally lead to overstriding are reduced hip extension on the opposite leg. How does this work? So for example, this runner is having overstriding on the right hand side leg. Imagine a situation if he's having reduced hip extension on the left hand side, which is the opposite side. So at the push off point of the left leg, when the left leg is propelling the body forward, if he is not having good hip extension, he will not be getting good propulsion and he will not be covering a lot of distance in that stride. So how does the body make up for it? It extends the opposite leg, which is the right leg in this case, it extends it a lot so as to make up for that lost distance due to lesser propulsion, which leads to overstriding. So any kind of lag in propulsion in the opposite side, if it is due to a physical limitation like reduced hip extension, would lead to overstriding. Then there is excessive anterior pelvic tilt, generally goes hand in hand with reduced hip extension, would also lead to overstriding. There are a number of other factors also that you should look out for. Striding, like somebody who's having a hamstring weakness on the stance leg who's just striking the ground, might also lead to overstriding. Any kind of technical problems like faulty running mechanics. For amateur runners who want to increase their stride length, they would want to again extend their knee a lot by increase their stride. So that is again a technical fault that might lead to overstriding. Now, if a person is overstriding because of this technical problem, even though we give them a rehab program to correct any physical limitation, unless we correct this technical problem also, we will not be able to correct the root cause of overstriding in this case. Another technical fault is lack of forward trunk lean. So people who are bent posteriorly or have a completely upright trunk or absolutely no amount of forward trunk lean will also be a good candidate for overstriding. You can see in this case also, this person is having a very upright trunk lean. Typically, there should be a small amount of 5 to 10 degree of forward trunk lean if you want to reduce the chances of overstriding. Let's talk about corrections for overstriding now. Now, if the cause of overstriding is due to a physical limitation in the body, like somebody who's having a reduced hip extension, obviously you would want to give them a rehab program. It could be a strength and conditioning program to remove that physical limitation in the body. So improving hip extension, good eccentric training for quads are two things that we have felt improve the chances of reducing overstriding if it is a physical limitation in the body. Now let's talk about if the problem is due to a technical fault. So if the physically the person is fine, just that technically to increase their performance they are doing overstriding. In that case, we use a process known as cadence retraining, in which we increase the cadence of or the steps per minute that the person takes by 5 to 10%. When we increase the cadence, automatically their foot is not able to land too far ahead of the center of mass, so they are not able to extend their knee a lot. They have to take shorter steps, so they exhibit immediately good amount of knee flexion and they show a fairly vertical tibia, as you can see on the photograph on the left. And the next thing you can encourage them is to have a softer landing. So this is a verbal cue you can give them when they're running, which will immediately improve knee flexion. You can encourage them to take shorter steps, which is a part of cadence retraining again. You can ask them to have a small degree of forward trunk lean to reduce the chance of overstriding again. Once we are done with overstriding, we next come to a fault known as medial collapsor. This is again a fault you will find very commonly in a lot of runners that come to you. This is a fault that you will be able to analyze during an event known as mid stance, when both the knees are adjacent to each other, and it will be characterized by a number of features, like there would be excessive pelvic drop contralaterally. It can be accompanied by ipsilateral trunk lean also. There would be absolutely no spacings between the knee. The knees would be just brushing past each other, which would be reducing the knee window. It can also be accompanied with excessive foot eversion. So all of these factors when combined will lead to this medial collapsor fault. On the opposite side, if you can see, this person is not having the medial collapsor fault. So there is a small amount of ipsilateral trunk lean as opposed to excessive. There is approximately a level pelvis. There is a good wide knee window present here, accompanied with normal foot eversion. So there is no excessive foot eversion here. So this is the difference between a person who is exhibiting that fault and the person who is not exhibiting that fault. A lot of problems that happen due to this fault is a lot of patellofemoral pain problems, IT band problems happen a lot due to this, greater cantor syndrome, piriformis syndrome, lumbar pelvic pain, and a lot of stress fractures that happen if somebody is exhibiting this kind of a fault. And if we talk about causes, generally a weakness in hip abductors would lead to excessive contralateral pelvic drop. If there is excessive dynamic knee valgus that is present, It would again reduce that knee window. Excessive foot pronation can lead to excessive foot eversion. In severe cases, femoral anteversion can again lead to this kind of a medial collapse or gait. If there's a technical problem, then a person who is trying to achieve a minimum stride width will try to show this kind of a medial collapse or fault. Let's see how that functions. So if I want to run with a very minimal stride width, I will have to drop this opposite pelvis down so that it comes, so the knee comes inside and down. And when it comes inside, it automatically lands with a on the in the next initial contact, it lands with a very minimal stride width. So if a runner is achieving wants to achieve a very minimal stride width, he might want to exhibit this kind of a gait. In that case, it would be a more of a technical problem. All of these upper factors were physical limitations in the body. Let's talk about corrections now. So we have seen that so if there is a weakness in the abductors, then yes, strength training helps, but there's still very limited evidence going around it that what is the effect of strength training. Are we able to correct excessive pelvic drop because of that during running or not? Another strategy that people are using these days to very good effect is using a feedback training to maintain a level pelvis. So what they do is they place a red colored or a different color strap on the waist, and they place a mirror in front of the runner who is running, or probably show a live feed using cameras, and they ask them or cue them to maintain a level pelvis when they run. So when they're using that cue, it immediately gives them a very quick reaction time. It gives them a very good immediate correction of the problem. They're able to maintain a very level pelvis. So this is another strategy you can use. Encouraging them to keep their knees apart, this can also be a very good strategy. And obviously, increasing the cadence, increasing the steps per minute by just 5 to 10% at a time can again reduce the chances of this problem from having drastically. Another fault that is again common in runners is crossover gait. A crossover gait is again visualized at mid-stance when both the knees are just side by side to each other. It is seen better from posterior view. As you can see on the photograph on the left and the photograph on the right have two basic differences. So there is excessive pelvic drop here. There is almost a level pelvis here. The second factor is that if I draw a vertical line passing through the center of the body, the stance phase leg is crossing that line, which is not happening in this particular case. A person who is exhibiting this kind of a pattern, crossing that center line, is showing a crossover gait. Now, crossover gait is the leading cause for IT band problems, because more I cross over across that line, greater the stretch that happens in the IT band. It leads to a lot of IT band problems. So, which is why when we talk about problems, the top problem we talk about would be IT band syndrome. Along with that is medial tibial stress injuries, bone stress injuries, and greater cantor syndromes are generally highly reported if somebody is having a crossover gait. The way to identify it again would be the same. The person would be crossing over the center line, passing through the, probably you can pass a line through the L3 or L5, and the person would be crossing over that line. Let's talk about causes for crossover. So weakness in hip abductors and dynamic knee valgus are leading causes of crossover gait. Let's see how that works. So in this case, for example, this person is having excessive contralateral pelvic drop. The left leg, the left pelvis is dropping excessively. So this person would have a tendency to show crossover gait on the left hand side also, because if the left pelvis is dropping excessively, the left knee would go down and it would go inside. And if it goes inside at the left initial contact, this person would again cross that line, showing an crossover gait pattern. So it's generally leaned on the opposite side. That if you have hip abductor weakness, for example, on the right hand side in this case, you would be showing crossover gait on the opposite side. So pelvic drop, excessive contralateral pelvic drop, and crossing over that midline are closely related to each other. Again, there could be a case when the person is having a tendency to minimize their stride width, and then because of that, they're exhibiting crossover gait. This is a fault that yes, you will find in a lot of people, because minimizing stride width to some extent is more economical from a running point of view also. Let me explain how does that work. So if you can do this experiment right now on yourself also, just try to stand up and walk with a very exaggerated stride width, and you'll realize that immediately there is a lot of side-to-side movement that is happening. Now, this side-to-side movement does not add any value in my forward motion. It is excessive energy expenditure. Similar is the case with running. Minimal is my stride width, minimal is that side-to-side motion, and minimal is that excessive energy expenditure. So a runner would want to minimize their stride width in order to decrease excessive energy expenditure. A person who's overdoing it will show crossover gait. So this is if a technical problem is present. Just as a word of caution, running speed as it increases, the tendency to crossover also increases. But at a speed of say 12 km per hour, crossover should not be present. Let's talk about corrections for this. Again, as we saw in case of the medial collapsor gait, encouraging them to have a level pelvis, again using a mirror or a camera-based visual feedback can be very helpful. This will help them to maintain a level pelvis, and when they land on the initial contact, they will not land on the opposite side of that line. They will not cross that central line of the body. Encouraging a slightly wider base of support can also be very helpful. You can do this by asking them to run along a straight line and making sure that the feet are on the either side of the line and they're not crossing over that. There are certain strategies that people use to ensure this. So they ask people to run constantly about a line, and then for a 20-second period, they just ask them to look down and consciously see that they are not crossing that line. Then after that 20-second period, they're running for some amount of time, say 5-10 minutes. Then again for a 20-second period, they look down and consciously make an effort to not cross that line. The last fault that we'll be talking about would be the increased vertical oscillation of the center of mass of the body. So during the entire gait cycle, in the entire stance phase, swing phase, there is a net up and down movement of the center of mass of the body. The center of mass you can approximate at the center of the pelvis. In certain cases, people also take the retrovantral of the femur as the center of mass approximate location. So what this fault indicates is that during the entire gait cycle, there is a net up and down movement of the trunk, because at mid stance we are at maximum flexion, as you can see in this case. At probably the float phase, when both the feet are in the air, center of mass is at the highest. So there is a net up and down movement. In some people who jump higher after propulsion, the net vertical oscillation increases, which leads to a harder landing on the ground. If I jump higher, I land harder on the ground, and if I land harder on the ground, I need to do greater amount of shock absorption. So in people who have excessive amount of this vertical oscillation, they are said to have this fault. A common name for these kind of runners is also called as bounders. So bounding is also another name for this biomechanical fault. You can, apart from this measurement of up and down motion, you can also visualize this particular fault through the treadmill. If you're analyzing your runner on the treadmill, there would be a significant amount of shaking in the treadmill, because when I land harder, the treadmill shakes more. So it is an auditory, there is an auditory method also of visualizing if this fault is present or not. I would recommend that you use a professional software to analyze this fault is present or not, because in that you'll be able to exactly measure in centimeters what is the amount of net and up and down movement that they have. So let's see what are the causes of this particular fault of bounding or increased vertical oscillation. If I'm having reduced hip extension, so people who are having reduced hip extension will obviously have reduced propulsion. If I'm having reduced propulsion, I will not be able to propel my body very forward in the stride. What people do is they jump higher because of that. So if they jump higher, they are able to spend more time in the air, and they are able to cover more distance in the air, hence making up for that lost propulsion. The problem happens when they land harder on the ground. So which is why a lot of tibial stress fractures, reduced running economy problems, and increased joint loading problems are generally a result of increased vertical oscillation. how to correct it so I can ask the runner to increase their cadence, to increase the steps per minute, which will bring down the net up and down movement. I can also ask them to do a softer landing. I can give them verbal cues to I can encourage a softer landing, which will further reduce this net up and down movement. Just to clarify, there is some amount of up and down movement that happens. Any excessive up and down movement is a problem. So that is when we are when we say that this fault is present. So now we have covered all the major faults that you need to absolutely identify. There are a number of other variables that you should measure, but for a starter, these faults will cover a lot of things. To help you in your starting a process, you can take up a digital camera which has a good slow motion feature or a 60 FPS feature at least. And you can take up a phone which again has these slow motion features. You can use either of these two equipments or use both of them to capture the motion of the athlete from multiple views. And then to analyze that motion, you can take up a motion analysis software. To start off, you can just use your regular video player in your computer to play, pause the video, to play the video in slow motion and just visually identify these faults. The other option is to use a professional software with proper reporting features. So both of these type of examinations are qualitative and quantitative examinations. So just visualizing a video, just seeing if this person is having excessive pelvic drop or actually quantifying it are two different things. So the photo on the left is a qualitative examination. The photo on the right is a quantitative examination. This is what the difference will be between a normal video player and a professional software. So the a proper quantitative analysis will reduce inter-rater variations because it will break down everything in terms of values. So if I start analyzing a runner today, I'm not that experienced as you. And if you start analyzing the same runner, there would be a minimal variation between what both of us see. It is again very easy for the patient to understand because obviously they're not very aware about these clinical terms, these deviations. Even this break the, when you break thing down in things down in numbers, it will be very easy for them to understand. You can do good pre and post comparisons. Some variables are hard to assess without actually quantifying them. So for that, for those cases, you can actually so for example, we talked about bounding. If you want to measure the actual distance, the net up and down movement in centimeters, what is the movement that is happening? It's very hard to see using the eye. That you can measure easily using softwares. Some softwares like in GaitON, we give you a set of normal values also. What parameters are lying outside the range? What parameters lying inside the range? We give you asymmetries. Is there any asymmetry present in the left and the right hand side? So, depending upon what things you want, you can choose to opt for a particular system. Lastly, if there is any other help you need from my end regarding a setting up motion analysis at your center or in a research project that you're doing, feel free to reach out to me. I've mentioned my email and phone number here. You can also connect with me on LinkedIn. I can also keep on writing blogs on our website regarding motion analysis. So you can read them at optimum.com. You can catch up on a lot of information regarding GaitON also there. Overall, I hope you got to learn something out of this webinar. Any feedback, you can feel free to get in touch with me. And thank you for watching this.